Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the museum's Walter and Leonore Annenberg Theater. I'm Jan Newharth, the Chair and Chief Executive Officer of the Freedom Forum. Today, we have the honor of being joined by U.S. Deputy Attorney General Rod Rosenstein as we celebrate the 60th anniversary of Law Day, a day established by President Dwight D. Eisenhower on May 1, 1958, to mark the nation's commitment to the rule of law. We look forward to hearing from the Deputy Attorney General today as he discusses the rule of law, the First Amendment, and the mission of the Department of Justice. Mr. Rosenstein was sworn in as the 37th Deputy Attorney General on April 26, 2017. Prior to becoming Deputy Attorney General, he served as the United States Attorney for the District of Maryland from 2005 until 2017, where he oversaw federal criminal and civil litigation and developed and implemented federal law enforcement strategies in Maryland. In total, Mr. Rosenstein has served in the Department of Justice for nearly three decades under five presidents and nine attorneys general. Our moderator today is Ronald Collins, a constitutional law and First Amendment expert and the Harold S. Scheffelman Scholar at the University of Washington School of Law. Ron served as a Supreme Court Fellow under Chief Justice Warren Burger, and in 2011, the Supreme Court Fellows Alumni Association recognized him for his scholarly and professional achievements in advancing the rule of law. Ron was also a scholar for many years at our own First Amendment Center. The mission of the museum is to increase public understanding of the importance of a free press and the First Amendment. Since we opened the museum on Pennsylvania Avenue more than 10 years ago, more than 8 million visitors have experienced the story of news, the role of a free press in major events in history, and how the five freedoms of the First Amendment, religion, speech, press, petition, and assembly, apply to their lives. The Freedom Forum Institute, our education and programs partner, convenes programs like this one today so that people of all beliefs can come together to discuss pressing issues related to our First Amendment freedoms. Each and every day, through our exhibits and programming, the museum and the Freedom Forum Institute inform our visitors about the valuable role journalists serve in our democracy. We'd like to welcome and thank our museum members and our friends of the First Amendment Society, whose continuing support makes these programs possible. And now, please join me in welcoming our moderator, Ron Collins, and our guest, U.S. Deputy Attorney General Rod Rosenstein.
Thank you, John. Great to be here. Thank you. Thank you.
Mr. Deputy Attorney General, thank you very much for participating in this event today. I'd like to begin with a question that's on everybody's mind.
Uh-oh.
And I would appreciate a clear and direct answer to set the record straight. How do you pronounce your last name? Is it Rosenstein or Rosenstein?
So there's no right answer to that question. My family, my father pronounces it Stein. That's how I pronounce it. But I actually have relatives who pronounce it Steen, so I'll answer to either one.
All right. You agreed to do this public interview with no screened questions in advance, in the presence of the press, and without any reservations other than pending cases. The question I have is, why?
Well, I couldn't turn down this invitation, particularly on Law Day, which is very significant to me. I've devoted my career to the rule of law in the Department of Justice. And I think it's important for us to take opportunities like this to get out the word about the rule of law, to explain what it means and why it's so critical to our democracy.
So I think it would be a fair statement to say that the office of the Deputy Attorney General has, by and large, over the course of history, been one that has not been at the forefront of people's minds. I assume that most people, even those in the academy, couldn't identify past deputy attorney generals. So tell me, what happened?
Well, I'm looking forward to regaining my anonymity, but it's funny, I have been in the department for almost 30 years, and but for that, I might not have known the deputies either, but I do, because I've been in the department. We've had some really superb men and women serve as Deputy Attorney General. When I took the job, I'd been U.S. Attorney for 12 years in Baltimore, and my family and I live in Bethesda, just outside D.C., so we're in the D.C. media market. As a result, the kids didn't really see me much in the media while they were growing up, and my younger daughter was 14 at the time when she heard I was going to become deputy. She asked me a very important question. She said, "Dad, does this mean you'll get your picture in the paper?" And I said, "No." So it was quite unexpected.
All right. Today is Law Day, and given that, I think it's appropriate to ask, what do you think is the most serious threat to the rule of law in America today?
I don't think there's any threat to the rule of law in America today. The reason for that is that the rule of law in America is protected by two things, the Constitution and the culture. And the president issued a proclamation today in honor of Law Day, and it's really a wonderful proclamation. It's one page. I commend it to you. He speaks about the origin of Law Day. It actually began in 1957. In fact, President Eisenhower established the first Law Day, adopted in 57. I think the first one was celebrated in, or commemorated in 58. And one of the key speakers at the event here in Washington, D.C. at the federal courthouse was William Rogers, who was then the Attorney General of the United States. His portrait hangs in the conference room of the Deputy Attorney General's office. And since then, we've commemorated it every year as a recognition of the centrality of the rule of law to American life. But in the President's proclamation today, he makes two really important points. First off is that he quotes Supreme Court Justice Antonin Scalia, who spoke about the fact that the rule of law is not just about written words in a constitution. It's about the culture of the people. Right? You can write a constitution that has a Bill of Rights, but there are totalitarian countries where they don't enforce those rights. So the rule of law is in part about the character of the people who are charged with enforcing the law. And the other point the president makes is that the separation of powers enshrines the rule of law in America. The fact that we do divide our powers between Congress, which enacts the law, the executive branch, which is responsible for implementing or carrying out the law, and the courts, which are responsible for interpreting it. Now, there are always disputes at the margins between the branches, the differences of agreement over issues, but the fundamental structure set up by the separation of powers is really important to guarding the rule of law. So I think it's partly about culture, partly about structure, and partly about the rights enshrined in the Constitution.
If you would permit me, and I hope you will, I'd like to take a liberty. I'd like to hand you a piece of paper with some words on it.
It's not a subpoena, is it? I'll take it.
He's stealing my thunder. But I'm happy to give it to you. Uh-huh. So I'd like to hand you a piece of paper with the words of a famous American. I'd like you to just take a look at it. And then if you'd be so kind to read it slowly and aloud to the audience. Here you go.
Well, this is Robert Jackson. This, Robert Jackson was the Attorney General of the United States in the Roosevelt administration. His portrait also hangs in the Deputy Attorney General's conference room, and he gave a speech in the Great Hall of the Department of Justice, April 1st of 1940. And he spoke about the role of the federal prosecutor, and it really is, for federal prosecutors, it really is a guidebook. Even now, many decades later, really stands as the most significant articulation of the principles that govern prosecutors. And this particular excerpt reads the qualities...
If I may, forgive me. I did not give him the name or... he said right. April 1st, 1940. I mean, this is right from the top, so I just wanted to make sure we credit yes. you for that.
Well, it is one of my favorite quotes.
Yes, sir.
And I encourage you to read the whole thing, but this is actually the concluding paragraph. It says, the qualities of a good prosecutor are as elusive and as impossible to define as those which mark a gentleman, and you should read, or woman, and those who need to be told would not understand it anyway. A sensitiveness to fair play and sportsmanship is perhaps the best protection against the abuse of power, and the citizen's safety lies in the prosecutor who tempers zeal with kindness, who seeks truth and not victims, who serves the law and not factional purposes, and who approaches his task with humility.
I didn't even need to give it to you.
Probably not.
Humility is not a word very much honored in this town. Can you say a few words about humility and being in public service?
You know, I actually have not spent that much of my career in Washington. I've spent about half my entire career with the Department of Justice, but about half of it with the U.S. Attorney's Office in Maryland, outside the D.C. Beltway, so it's really a different atmosphere. There is something different about Washington. It's the intensity of the media scrutiny, you know, the significance of the people that you interact with in Washington that makes it very different. But for prosecutors, there's a certain discipline that comes from our role in the judicial system. And the most significant aspect of it is that when we make an allegation of misconduct in the Department of Justice, when we accuse somebody of criminal wrongdoing, we have an obligation to prove it in court beyond any reasonable doubt. So we have to have admissible evidence that complies with the rules of evidence. We need to have eyewitnesses, firsthand eyewitnesses who are credible to testify about what they've seen. We present our evidence in a court before a judge who applies the rules. We have a jury of 12 random citizens. And only if every one of those citizens agrees beyond any reasonable doubt with the government's case do we prevail. And of course, on the other side, you typically have a very skilled defense attorney who has the opportunity to introduce evidence on the other side. So that imposes on prosecutors, I think, a certain discipline and humility because you recognize what it takes to put these cases together. And it causes us, in the best of times at least, to be much more cautious about allegations that we make, to be much more concerned about whether or not we're going to have the evidence to back up any claims that we make. And I think that does require a certain level of humility.
So given your admiration for the former Attorney General and then Supreme Court Justice Robert Jackson, I'd like to read you another line from that speech and ask for your comments. At one point, Mr. Jackson said, your responsibility, and here he was speaking to attorneys in the Department of Justice, it took place in the Great Hall there, as you know, and he said, your responsibility for law enforcement and for its methods cannot be wholly surrendered to Washington. Mm-hmm. How do you interpret that? What does it mean? What does that statement mean to you?
Attorney General Jackson was speaking to U.S. attorneys, the senior law enforcement appointees from around the country. I think it was the second annual gathering in the Department of Justice. That Great Hall is still where we hold our gatherings. The building had only been built a few years before. It's a very majestic spot. And what the Attorney General was conveying to the U.S. attorneys was he was recognizing the tension between their traditional independence as U.S. attorneys making independent decisions in their judicial districts and the leadership and guidance from Maine Justice in Washington. Now, this was a couple of generations ago. To give you a little historical perspective, at the founding of the country, there was an attorney general, there were U.S. attorneys in each of the 13 states, but there was no Department of Justice. There was no bureaucracy in Washington. In fact, the Department of Justice is an institution I don't believe was created until about 1860, 1870 or so. And so over time, in the era where Jackson was speaking, and also if you can imagine what it was like in the early days, there was very little ability to control things in the field. If you're the Attorney General sitting in Washington, your U.S. attorney in Maine is not available on email. You can't call him on the phone. So you really can't communicate on a real-time basis. Therefore, you need to defer to the decisions made in the field. And in Jackson's era, there was an effort to consolidate responsibility in the department and impose some degree of consistency and uniformity. Because when you have independent actors throughout the country, enforcing their own interpretation of the law, you're going to get different interpretations in different places. And so Jackson was addressing that tension between the desire to have some level of uniformity and control from main justice in Washington and the need for each U.S. attorney in their district to be able to tailor their priorities to the local needs. And we're obviously several generations later now. So we still see that tension flare up from time to time, but for the most part as a result of modern communication and the culture that the department has generated, the existence, for example, of a U.S. attorney's manual and formal policies that govern the department. We have a much greater degree of uniformity around the country. We still do have, though, different priorities. If you're in a district with very little violent crime, you're not going to devote a lot of resources to violent crime. That's just one example. So that's really the issue that Jackson was referring to. It was the coordination within the executive branch.
Well, I want to turn to the attorney's manual in a moment, but before I do, I'd like to read a statement made during your confirmation hearings for your current position. And you said, and I quote, you were saying this to the Senate committee, "If you confirm my nomination, I will work to defend the integrity and independence of our Justice Department." Can you elaborate on what you meant by saying independence? In what sense is the Justice Department independent?
The Justice Department is independent of inappropriate political considerations. I think it's important to recognize it's not independent of the executive branch. The department has a responsibility to be in accord with the priorities of the administration. And that's what elections are for. We have changes of priorities, we change our emphasis, we change some of our policies. But in the individual decisions we make, for example, about who to prosecute in particular, those decisions have to be made without regard to politics. So we decide we're going to focus on violent crime or public corruption, for example. But then in making the decisions about which cases and which people to prosecute, we need to apply neutral principles. And that's what we mean when we talk about the independence of the Justice Department.
The Department of Justice is, as you've just mentioned, a part of the executive branch, but it is also the entity charged with enforcing the rule of law. Given how human nature works, there are certain to be conflicts between the two. Can you tell us how you go about managing those conflicts?
Conflicts between which?
The rule of law and certain demands made by the chief executive.
No. No, there are no such conflicts.
I'm just saying that this is part of human nature. Right. I mean, it's nothing peculiar to our time.
No, the way we operate, the Department of Justice, and the way this administration operates is not necessarily the way you see it caricatured in the media. There's no doubt by anybody in the Department of Justice that we are complying with the rule of law. We are enforcing the priorities of the administration. There have been significant changes, obviously, in some of the department's priorities, but we apply them in a way that's consistent with the rule of law.
As mentioned earlier, you've served under five presidents, nine attorneys general. You've served both for Republican and Democratic administrations. That itself is a remarkable feat in these days. And I'm curious, I've just asked you about balancing the rule of law with the concerns of the executive. I'd like to ask you something about the other branch of government, the Congress. How do you go about balancing the department's need for confidential investigations against other branch demands for information concerning them? I mean, if you have an investigation on one hand and you have a demand for information about that, how do you go about balancing those two things?
Funny you should ask that question. It's a really important issue. You know, we in the department and in the executive branch, we strongly support appropriate congressional oversight. Oversight is very important, and it's one of our obligations to comply to the extent that we can. Interesting historical point, as the president's proclamation today mentions, there are three branches with three distinct authorities. There's actually not a constitutional basis for oversight. That's something that's been viewed as sort of an implied power and has developed over the years, and there are conflicts between the executive and legislative branch over oversight throughout history. And I've been in the department for almost 30 years. Going back hundreds of years, these conflicts have arisen. And what we've been told, in the few instances where this has actually been litigated, the courts have said that the branches have a responsibility to try to compromise, responsibility to get along. And there have been repeated articulations over the years about what the principles, the sort of red lines are, you know, where it's not appropriate to conduct congressional oversight. Justice Jackson, when he was Attorney General, actually wrote a very well-known Attorney General opinion around 1941 where he addressed just that issue, and he refused, flatly refused, to give Congress access to FBI records. So that was the policy in 1941. Policies have evolved somewhat since then, but when the issue has flared up from time to time, as it did, for example, in 1989, William Barr, who became Attorney General when he was Assistant Attorney General, wrote a similar opinion letter in a dispute with Congress and explained how these controversies, these disagreements are bound to occur from time to time. And then in 1999, the Assistant Attorney General for Legislative Affairs, Robert Rabin, did it again. So it's not a novel issue, but what has been established over time is that we have responsibility to work with the Congress, but they have responsibility to understand that their duty is not to interfere with ongoing investigations to the Department of Justice, not to do anything that might compromise national security or endanger informants. And we have different responsibilities in the department than they do. And as long as everybody understands that, typically we're able to work these issues out. But one of the things that developed in order to deal with this issue was the Inspector General. We have an Inspector General at the Department of Justice who is an executive branch employee who is bound by the confidentiality rules of the Department of Justice and has greater access to department records than it would be appropriate to give Congress. And so that really is the purpose of the Inspector General, and I think there's some, among some people, a misunderstanding about what the Inspector General does. The Inspector General is actually a fully functional law enforcement agency with auditors and with armed federal agents who have the ability to go in and conduct investigations and gather evidence. And what we've developed over the years with our Inspector General, and this has not necessarily been easy because there have been conflicts over the years as well, but we've actually reached an accord where the department freely shares information with the Inspector General that would be highly inappropriate for public release, with the understanding that that Inspector General is not going to publicly disclose the information. Their responsibility is to determine if there was wrongdoing, if there is, to make sure that appropriate punishments are imposed, but not to go ahead and release that information publicly. So we do have within the department internal mechanisms to deal with serious allegations of misconduct,
audience, I think there's a lot of misunderstanding about this. Can you tell us about the difference between special counsels and independent prosecutor?
How much time do we have?
Well, don't take too much time, because I have some other good questions I want to ask you.
A U.S. senator asked me this and then got upset when I tried to give a full answer because I only had 30 seconds. But it's dramatically different. Now, I worked for an independent counsel. I worked for the Whitewater Independent Counsel. And I taught a course at University of Maryland for quite a few years where we did an entire session on the role of the independent counsel, the differences between an independent counsel and a federal prosecutor, accountable to the executive branch. The fundamental difference is that an independent counsel under the law that was in place until from the Watergate era until 1999 with a couple of breaks, that law involved the appointment of a prosecutor by the court. And that is very far from our traditional model, because everybody in the Department of Justice is ultimately accountable to the Attorney General and to the President. And prosecutor appointed by the court is not. That was the purpose of the law. And soon after it was passed, there was a landmark Supreme Court case in which the constitutionality of the law was challenged. And I'm sure you've taught this case. It's Morrison v. Olson was the case. Ted Olson challenged Alexia Morrison's authority to conduct that investigation. And the Supreme Court overwhelmingly rejected the challenge and found that the independent counsel statute was constitutional. Now, a lot of people have reservations about that, including me. And they're articulated in a dissenting opinion by Justice Scalia, who I mentioned earlier. And Justice Scalia pointed out in his dissenting opinion that independent counsels who are not accountable to the executive branch operate very differently from ordinary prosecutors. And so a special counsel is very different. A special counsel is very much like an acting U.S. attorney. We now have a number of U.S. attorneys confirmed around the country. They've been approved by the Senate. We also have a number of U.S. attorneys where there were vacancies, and so the Attorney General appointed somebody to be U.S. attorney. That person exercises the power of the U.S. attorney. It's accountable to the Department of Justice and ultimately the Attorney General, but has not been Senate confirmed. A special counsel is actually very much like that. And the special counsel model is actually not new. It's been used repeatedly over American history. Bill Barr, in his two-year term, I believe, appointed three special counsels for discrete matters. And so they have been used over the years. And what's significantly different between special counsels and independent counsels is that they're accountable to the department through the chain of command. When you're an independent counsel, you get your marching orders, your document that's approved by the court that states your authority, and that's all you have. When you're a special counsel, you actually have an ongoing reporting relationship with the Attorney General. And we now have a regulation. Our special counsels have been appointed since 1999, have also been governed by a regulation that provides supplemental guidance for how they go about doing their jobs. So in a relatively brief period of time, that's my short answer, it's dramatically different. There is accountability, which I think actually is very important. I respect the Supreme Court's judgment in Morrison v. Olson, but I think it's actually very important that a special counsel is accountable to the Attorney General, and that if there are any violations of department policies or principles or prosecution standards, they can be corrected because the special counsel reports to the Attorney General.
Earlier this year, the Department of Justice filed a statement of interest in a First Amendment case involving the University of California at Berkeley. In short, the issue at stake was a charge of exorbitant security fees for certain controversial figures who spoke, or allegedly controversial figures who spoke on campus. The Department of Justice filed a statement of interest supporting the First Amendment claim there. And I'd like to read you a passage from that statement of interest filed by the DOJ. And it says, "The United States has an interest in protecting the individual rights guaranteed by the First Amendment." Mindful of those words, can you explain to us what U.S. attorney manuals are? Just say a few words about them. And then really the heart of the question I want to get to, particularly in this venue, is would you comment on a recent story in BuzzFeed that the Justice Department deleted language about press freedom from its internal manuals? Can you tell us about why it felt the need to do so?
Yes, thank you for asking that question. This is the ideal forum, actually, to address that. That particular change actually was made last fall, and I don't know whether somebody saved it for a day after the White House Correspondents' Dinner or why it was it popped up on that particular day, but it's a great, very cute talking point. DOJ eliminates First Amendment from U.S. Attorney's Manual, but it's completely misleading, let me assure you. That particular section of the manual is what used to be referred to as the media policy. It's in the U.S. Attorney's Manual, Title I, Section 7. And what we did, we rewrote the whole manual. We actually did that part at the beginning because we wanted to clarify the department's policy on confidentiality. And so we actually rewrote the entire section. Rather than focusing exclusively on media, it focuses on the confidentiality obligations of our employees. And it emphasizes that when you get non-public information in the Department of Justice, you should presume you have an obligation to keep that information non-public. Just by virtue of your employment, you're going to come across information. Some of it's classified, some is grand jury information, some is personal privacy information, information that might be embarrassing to American citizens, information that might jeopardize cases or informants, and you have an obligation to keep that information confidential. So the section was rewritten with that in mind. And I think if you read the whole thing, it's actually pretty well done. But there was a section that had the title First Amendment, and that's no longer there. But the First Amendment is protected here. In the US Constitution, it's not protected by the US Attorney's Manual, but it is protected by the Department of Justice. And so I can assure you that our employees, particularly our employees who deal with the media, are very cognizant of First Amendment concerns. But that's not a viable defense if you disclose classified information. And so if you take a job in the department or anywhere in government, you have access to information where you incur a legal obligation not to disclose it, that obligation that you've accepted voluntarily overrides any First Amendment interest that you may have. Now, that's different from the media, right? That's one of the ongoing battles that we face in government, is that the media's interest is in getting our people to leak, and our interest is in preventing our people from leaking. And we respect you doing your job, but we have to do our job.
Well, on that very point, does the department have any plans to change its policies concerning the subpoenaing of reporters?
We're reviewing that. You know, this policy that Ron is referring to has been modified over the years, most recently, I guess, about 4 years ago. And there have been some concerns that a number of our prosecutors have raised about aspects of the policy. The policy actually does give reporters special privileges because it protects them from subpoenas. It requires elevated approval within the department and provides certain procedural protections that don't exist for non-reporters. And so there are some aspects of it that we are evaluating. We've actually met with, we have an organization of media representatives that come in and meet with me every 4 or 5 months or so. And so we discuss proposed changes with them. We haven't made any changes, but it's possible. There are some aspects of it that we are reviewing.
Would the department be willing to meet with members of the press any time in the not-too-distant future to discuss these matters?
How many?
To your discretion.
Well, yes, we do. I mean, that's my point. We really do. We have a media, I think they call it the media advisory group, and it includes, I think, reporters and also media executives. I think there were probably about 8 people who attended the last meeting, and I find that to be really valuable. You know, we value the feedback. We recognize, you know, changes we make may not be popular, but we prefer to get the feedback in advance.
As I understand it, and as reported in a March 23rd, 2018 New York Times story, the department reversed its own recommendation on bump stocks. Is that true, and if so, why the change?
That's a caricature of the policy. The department had, what we've done this year is we're looking at whether or not it's appropriate for ATF to regulate bump stocks. And my understanding is the department previously hasn't done that. I'm not sure if it's a matter of changing positions because it's not a position. I don't think it's a position that we've taken in court. It's a matter of lawyers looking at the law and figuring out whether or not the proposed regulation fits within the law. We actually issued a month or two ago a notice of proposed rulemaking and solicited public comments. We got a lot of public comments. And I don't think a decision has yet been made about whether to proceed with that.
In his majority opinion in District of Columbia versus Heller, Justice Scalia made the following statement: "Nothing in our opinion should be taken to cast doubt on laws imposing conditions and qualifications on the commercial sale of arms." Given that language, do you think a narrowly tailored federal law banning the commercial sale of AR-15 semi-automatic weapons could withstand constitutional scrutiny under the Second and 14th Amendments?
So that sounds like a constitutional law exam question for your students. It's not one that would be appropriate for me to answer. When these kind of issues come up in the Department of Justice, I don't just pop off with my opinion. We actually have lawyers who are skilled in this sort of thing who will do an analysis, and we'll work it through the chain of command and reach a reasoned decision. So many of these issues are complex legal issues, and I wouldn't want to offer an opinion off the cuff.
Would you say, notwithstanding your comment or respectful of it, that the statement I read, again, nothing in our opinion should be taken to cast doubt on laws imposing conditions and qualifications on the commercial sale of arms, would it be fair to say that given that statement, the Second Amendment right is not absolute?
You know, I regret I'm not going to comment on that. You can't ask Justice Scalia, sadly. But, you know, Supreme Court opinions are read for what they mean, and they often have significance in future cases. But the general proposition in the law, we wait for a particular case, and we look at the factual circumstances and then consider how to apply the precedent.
How many U.S. attorneys remain to be nominated and confirmed? Do you know?
Not many. We have, there are 93 U.S. attorneys around the country, 94 judicial districts. We have one U.S. attorney who serves Guam and the Northern Mariana Islands. I believe we're more than two-thirds of the way through in terms of nominating, and there are many folks who are in the pipeline. It's actually a lengthy process to be approved as U.S. attorney. You go through the selection process, and then once you've been tentatively selected, you go through a background investigation that can take 2 or 3 months, and then you have to go through Office of Government Ethics, which reviews your finances. That can take another month or two, so it can take a long time to get people through that pipeline. But there are only a handful of offices that do not have either presidentially appointed, Senate confirmed U.S. attorneys already in place or somewhere in the pipeline. We actually moved fairly quickly in filling those positions, and Congress has actually moved fairly quickly in confirming our U.S. attorneys, in contrast to some of our main justice and other D.C.-based officials.
This past March, Attorney General Sessions said the department was committed to moving promptly and aggressively on federal gun prosecutions, namely situations where people lie when they apply for an application for a weapon. Can you tell us what's going on in that area?
Yes. Well, that's a very good example of how we make a policy decision in Washington, and then we roll it out to the field. So the Attorney General notified our U.S. attorneys that he wanted them to devote more resources, to be more aggressive in pursuing cases of people who make false statements in the course of buying firearms, often or primarily misrepresenting that they have no disqualifying felony conviction when in fact they do. And so that guidance goes out from the Attorney General. The two relevant agencies are the United States attorneys, the 93 of them around the country, and the Bureau of Alcohol, Tobacco, Firearms, and Explosives, which is responsible for investigating these crimes. And so in order to implement this policy, I'm responsible for overseeing those agencies and making sure that the ATF agents are devoting more resources to investigating these lie-and-buy cases, and that the federal prosecutors are devoting the resources required to prosecute them. This is a relatively new initiative, so it's too soon to see results, but you would anticipate that over the next 6 to 8 months, we'll see an increase in the number of false statement cases brought relating to firearms purchases.
Another deletion from the U.S. attorney, as I understand it, from the manual, concerned gerrymandering, racial gerrymandering. Can you tell us about why that decision was made to delete that?
Yes. My understanding, I asked about this after the story showed up in the newspaper yesterday, and my understanding is that there are, as Deputy Attorney General, some people assume that I'm micromanaging things, but I'm not, unfortunately. And so issues would come to my attention if there were a dispute between the relevant parties. In this case, the Civil Rights Division actually reviewed the civil rights title of the U.S. Attorney's Manual, and the changes that they made, to the best of my understanding, were actually recommended by the career prosecutors and then approved by the political staff, and so there were no issues that never came to my attention. My understanding is that particular issue, the determination was made that the guidance was unnecessary and outdated and addressed an issue that had not arisen in the past decade or more. And our goal was, over time, the U.S. Attorney's Manual accreted a tremendous amount of material to the point where it just wasn't all that useful to our prosecutors. Our goal is to have a ready resource that prosecutors can turn to for commonly occurring situations that will give them guidance about how to carry out their duties. And so the directions that we gave to the folks who did the review were, if there's anything in there that's just rhetoric, that's not serving any purpose in terms of guidance, we can delete it. You know, our goal isn't to restate the Constitution or restate all legal principles in the U.S. Attorney's Manual. The goal is simply to give guidance on issues that people may need guidance about. So my understanding of that issue is that the Civil Rights Division career staff determined that there was no need for it to be in the U.S. Attorney's Manual, and that's why it was deleted.
I have several more questions, but in the interest of uninhibited, robust, and wide-open discussion here in this venue, we'll be turning in about 4 minutes or so to questions from the audience. But I would like to ask one other question before we turn. Last year in a Constitution Day address you gave in Philadelphia, you made the following statement. The Constitution comes with a condition we need to keep it. And you emphasize this, I recall the word keep. Can you share with us your ideas on what you meant by that?
Yes. Yeah, that that actually related to a comment that Benjamin Franklin made when he was leaving the Constitutional Convention. Franklin lived near Independence Hall, which is where the founders met. The story is told that when Franklin was walking home after the Constitutional Convention, he came across a woman named Elizabeth Powell. And Mrs. Powell asked him, Dr. Franklin, what kind of government have you created? And when you think about it, it's a great teaching point for American history, because this country had been a monarchy. We were under the leadership of the King of England. And it wasn't clear, after we declared our independence, what sort of government structure we would have in America. And so Mrs. Powell didn't necessarily know what we would have. And Franklin's answer was, a republic, madam, if you can keep it. What he meant by that was that the founders had created the document, they had written the Constitution, but it was up to the people to decide whether that Constitution would be faithfully executed. I think one of the particularly revealing aspects of the story, it may be an apocryphal story, but one of the particularly revealing aspects of it is that Mrs. Powell, of course, being a woman, didn't even have a right to vote at the time. But Franklin said it was up to her and not him to keep the republic. And so that was the point of the comment, and it relates to what the president said in his proclamation today and what Justice Scalia wrote about the rule of law being dependent not just on the words on paper, but upon the culture and integrity of the people who are responsible for implementing it, and ultimately the people who are voting.
Well, with that, I would like to allow a little bit more time for questions from our audience. Please keep in mind that you'll be allowed one question, no follow-ups, all right? And a question, not a long diatribe. Please identify yourself, your name, and your affiliation at the outset. And as I've said, please remember that questions involving pending investigations or matters are beyond the pale. You can ask it, but that will be the use of your first and last question. With that, let us turn to the public. Sir, please introduce yourself, your name, and your affiliation.
Hi, Chris Strom with Bloomberg News. Thanks for doing this. I'm wondering what your mindset is on whether a sitting president can be indicted. If not, why not? And if not, or is there any consideration being given to changing department policy?
Okay, that was two questions. Chris, this is not a press conference. So I'm not going to answer this in the context of any current matters, so you shouldn't draw any inference about it. But the Department of Justice has, in the past, when the issue arose, has opined that a sitting president cannot be indicted. There's been a lot of speculation in the media about this. I just don't have anything more to say about it. That's when the issue arose, somebody in the department reached a legal conclusion, and that's what it is.
Gentlemen, please identify yourself.
Name is Richard Green. I'm a former lawyer. Happy Law Day. And appreciate the integrity you bring to your position. In any legal transaction, real estate or any contract, if there is fraud or illegality, that contract, that transaction can be rescinded. Why, if we have found or can find collusion or violations of elections law, or any other illegality in the 2016 election, if it is found, why can't the election be rescinded, declared void ab initio, and redone?
Because of this. to the best of my knowledge, there is no procedure to void an election. That's all there is.
Sir, please identify yourself and your affiliation.
My name is Jake Gibson. I'm with Fox News. Thank you very much. Can you assure the American people that you're the right man to oversee the Mueller investigation in the sense that it was your memo that was essentially used in the firing of Director Comey, at least in part, and now Mueller reportedly is investigating that very firing, among other things?
So that violates the rule, but the short answer is I don't comment on investigations. I don't comment on what we are investigating. I don't comment on what we're not investigating. And I can tell you a lot of things I read in the media or see on cable TV just aren't true. And people say, well, if it's not true, why don't you correct it? And the answer is because that's just not the way we operate. You know, we conduct investigations in secret. If we have a basis to prosecute somebody, we prosecute them. If we don't, We close our file and we go home.
Hi, my name is Josh Sachs. I'd like to ask you a historical question, if I may. One of your more famous predecessors, relatively famous, William Ruckelshaus. How would you assess his character for choosing to, instead of firing Archibald Cox at the direction of President Nixon, choosing to resign, knowing full well that someone down the chain of command probably would carry out that order?
So this is a Watergate reference. The Attorney General, Elliot Richardson, had made a commitment to the Senate that he would not fire the special prosecutor. He felt obligated to fulfill that commitment and therefore resigned rather than fire the special prosecutor. The deputy attorney general did as well. The solicitor general was Robert Bork, carried out the order. To the best of my knowledge, it wasn't an unlawful order. I don't think there was any regulation at the time that restricted the firing of the special counsel. I don't know all the historical details, but I think that Richardson and Ruckelshaus and Bork all made what they thought were principled decisions.
Yes, ma'am.
Hi there, Laura Jarrett from CNN. Thanks so much for doing this, Mr. Deputy Attorney General. As you think about the importance of separation of powers on Law Day here, any reaction to the news that certain members of the House Freedom Caucus have talked about drafting up articles of impeachment despite your best efforts to comply with their document requests?
They can't even resist leaking their own drafts.
Would you care to elaborate on that?
I saw that draft. I mean, I don't know who wrote it. It really does illustrate, though, a really important principle about the rule of law and a distinction between the way we operate in the department. And we make mistakes. That's not to say we're flawless. But the way we operate in the Department of Justice, if we can accuse somebody of wrongdoing, we have to have admissible evidence and credible witnesses. We need to prepare to prove our case in court. And we have to affix our signature to the charging document. That's something that not everybody appreciates. There's a lot of talk about FISA applications. And many people that I see talking about it seem not to recognize what a FISA application. A FISA application is actually a warrant, just like a search warrant. In order to get a FISA search warrant, you need an affidavit signed by a career federal law enforcement officer who swears that the information in the affidavit is true and correct to the best of his knowledge and belief. And that's the way we operate. And if it's wrong, sometimes it is, if you find out there's anything incorrect in there, that person is going to face consequences. Sometimes there are innocent errors, but if not, you can face discipline or potentially even prosecution. And so that's the way we operate. You know, we have people who are accountable. And so I just don't have anything to say about documents like that that nobody has the courage to put their name on and that they leak in that way. But I can tell you, you know, there have been people who have been making threats privately and publicly against me for quite some time. And I think they should understand by now the Department of Justice is not going to be extorted. We're going to do what's required by the rule of law. And any kind of threats that anybody makes are not going to affect the way we do our job. We have a responsibility. And we take an oath. That's the whole point. When you take these jobs, you need to be appointed by the president and confirmed by the Senate. And that actually is a pretty thorough process. And then you raise your right hand and you swear an oath to support and defend the Constitution of the United States against all enemies, foreign and domestic. You promise to bear true faith and allegiance to the same, and you take this obligation freely without any mental reservation or purpose of evasion, so help me God, and that's your responsibility. Everybody in the department takes that oath. We have 115,000 employees, and if they violate it, they know they're going to be held accountable, and I know those folks know that I'm not going to violate my oath.
Yes, ma'am.
Hi, I'm Penny Starr with Breitbart News. Could you comment on the length of time that investigations take? I'm speaking of the Mueller investigation, and people say they go on and on and on. Is there a precedent, or is there something that puts a time limit on this when the American people will get to know what he's discovered?
So everybody keeps breaking Ron's rule, and I'm condoning it. I'm not going to talk about the Mueller investigation. In general, you know, our goal is always to conclude every investigation as expeditiously as we can. And certainly any investigation that I oversee, I'm not talking about anyone in particular because I oversee a lot of investigations, we recognize the need to move them as expeditiously as possible.
Yes, ma'am.
Yes, my name is Laura Greenberg. I'm neither a lawyer nor a member of the press, but merely a
welcome.
Merely a concerned citizen. Deputy Secretary, you said at the beginning that you were not concerned about a breakdown in the rule of law, and you cited several factors, one of which was the culture of integrity and a belief that the people who are implementing the law were doing so fairly. If we have a president who is conveying exactly the opposite message and impugning all of those people, or many of them, is that not a reason for concern?
Yeah, as I said, the responsibility for implementing the rule of law is in the Department of Justice. And I understand the point of your question, but I think you also have to recognize the president's responsible for appointing the leadership of the Department of Justice. And I can tell you, because I work with these people day in and day out, he has appointed a leadership team for the Department of Justice that respects the rule of law. And that's why I'm quite confident that we're going to comply with the rule of law.
Yes, ma'am.
Louise Helen, I also am a citizen. I am wondering what you think is the differences in priorities with the current administration and the Department of Justice for First Amendment rights as about employment. So hiring, firing, you know, there's protected classes, but how is freedom of speech changing in the employment category?
Okay, so hiring and firing and the First Amendment, I'm not aware of any change in the department's policies in those areas. Do you have anything specific in mind?
Well, specifically, you know, there's been a lot of things coming up, like, you know, the NFL and different other issues where the question is, what's an ability of someone to protest while they're in an employment situation?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I mean, these issues don't all implicate the Department of Justice, but the specific answer to your question is, no, I'm not aware of any change in our civil rights division with regard to hiring and employment.
Yes, ma'am.
Sarah Lynch with Reuters. Thanks for doing this. The FBI search recently of the president's personal attorney's offices and home has raised a lot of questions. There's been a lot of dialogue in the press about protection of attorney-client privilege information, and the president himself has lambasted the search. I know you can't speak specifically about this case, but in general, can you talk about what the Justice Department's policies and procedures are when a rare instance like this occurs, and how there are safeguards in place to protect attorney-client privilege?
Yes, I can answer the second part of your question. yes, you know, I've been in this business a long time, and it's not unknown that we have reason or cause to conduct investigations that involve attorneys. Attorneys, unfortunately, sometimes are involved in crimes just like any non-attorneys, sad to say. But when those situations arise, Just like with reporters, we do have additional safeguards within the department. And so the department's policy, and I'm not going to talk about a particular case, but the department's policy actually requires for a search of an attorney's office that we take extra precautions. So the threshold is you have a federal agent, a career federal agent, has to swear under oath that information he's providing is true and correct, and it has to establish probable cause to believe a crime has occurred and that evidence may be located in the property to be searched. It has to be approved by the U.S. Attorney's Office, and if it's a sensitive matter, it may go all the way up the chain, potentially the U.S. Attorney. In addition to that, for attorney search warrants, we require consultation with the Department of Justice in Washington. And so they're required to come to the criminal division of the department. We have an office called the Office of Enforcement Operations, and they consult with OEO, and the primary purpose of that consultation is to ensure that appropriate precautions are taken, because what we're looking for, if we do search an attorney's office, we're not looking for privileged information. We don't want that. In fact, we can create a lot of problems for ourselves if we inadvertently get access to privileged information. So we establish what we call taint teams or screening teams to make sure that we don't get privileged information. And so that consultation requirement exists. And then, of course, in cases that may be of broader significance, the general policy in the department is that you provide notice up the chain of command because we prefer to hear about things from our own staff before we read them in the media. But the approval requirement, as I said, is elevated, and it's going to require a review within the U.S. Attorney's Office, within the FBI, within the Justice Department's Criminal Division. Of course, ultimately, this is all up to a federal judge. A federal judge needs to review that affidavit and assure him or herself that the affidavit establishes probable cause that would justify the search. Now, I caution you, that doesn't mean a crime occurred. And sometimes people make the mistake of assuming that a search warrant means that somebody's guilty of a crime. It doesn't. It means there's probable cause to believe that there's evidence that may be relevant to a crime. But the question of whether or not a crime occurred is a separate issue to be resolved at a separate time.
Our clock is winding down, so if you could make, I'd like to get two questions in, if we can, so please.
I'll be short. My name's Al Belcourt, just a member of the museum. Drawing upon your experience over the past several years and picking an arbitrary point 5 years ago and today, would you comment, please, on the morale of the line attorneys of the department and the special agents of the Bureau?
So I think the morale of the attorneys of the department is very high. And the reason I think that is because I talk with them quite often. In fact, just last week, I was at the U.S. Attorney's Office in Chicago, Illinois, and in Hammond, Indiana, Northern Indiana District. And I speak not just with assistant U.S. attorneys. I speak with support staff in the offices. I meet with heads of federal law enforcement agencies, and I meet with state and local law enforcement. And the message that we get consistently from those folks is that they feel they are being supported by the Department of Justice, and they feel that we have their backs and that we are doing what we need to do to help them suppress crime. Keep in mind, 85% of law enforcement officers are actually state and local, not federal. And so that's the feedback that I get. Obviously, nobody likes to see criticism in the news media, but our folks, you have to recognize, these are career folks who have chosen this career, and they understand that issues are going to heat up in the media from time to time. They're indicating, you know, from their perspective, as long as we're protecting their ability to do their job with integrity and they're investigating and prosecuting the right cases, I think their morale is going to remain high.
Unless you allow the liberty, I think our time is pretty much run. Since it's hard for them to say no in a First Amendment venue, please, this will be the last question, brief, if you will.
Hi, my name is Alicia Kiefer. I'm a high school student. I'm at a very impressionable age, and media plays a very big role in my life. Previously, you said that there are a lot of things that you see that are incorrect in media. How do I filter through that and form my opinions in today's society?
That's a very tough issue. I have two daughters about your age, 10th and 12th grades. One of my daughters wrote for her school newspaper, and I recall early on in my tenure as deputy AG, there was some relatively innocuous issue. I tried to avoid talking to my daughter about the deep issues, but some relatively innocuous issue. I told her it wasn't true, that I actually knew that this thing wasn't true. And she said, but Dad, if it isn't true, how could they put it in the newspaper? Because she was taught in her high school journalism class that you need reliable, credible sources. Unfortunately, here's the reality. I don't think most reporters are trying to mislead people. I think the problem is that they are hostage to their sources. And who's leaking? I'm not leaking, right? Who's leaking? The people who are leaking are people who have some personal motive, some reason they want to get their side of the story out. And so sometimes when you see leaks, for example, that relate to matters that we're investigating, I recognize it not to be, it's very unlikely to be a leak from law enforcement because it's wrong in some significant or subtle way, a mistake that we wouldn't make. But what do you do if you're a student trying to figure out what's an authoritative source? And so the advice I give my kids is when you read a story, first thing you need to do is look to see, is there a named source? If there's not a named source, you should be skeptical. Doesn't mean it's false. It just means you should be skeptical because if you don't have a named source, you can't corroborate it yourself. If it's a named source, then you have to evaluate what you know about that source and whether he or she is credible. And I think the most important thing, and this is what I tell my kids, is to read broadly. Because if you read broadly, you do develop a certain sense of what is and isn't right. And so that's the best advice that I can give you.
Ladies and gentlemen, what you've just witnessed is a rare moment in this town, namely a high-ranking public official speaking openly to the press and the public. On that note, will you please join with me in thanking our attorney, a Deputy Attorney General.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Thank you. Appreciate it.
Thank you.
Thank you. Join us. Thank you very much.